welcome to Championship Wrestling 81. With me are Jerry Brisco, the World Junior Heavyweight Champion, and the Take 5 expert, Barbara Clary. And, Jerry, first of all, I would think congratulations are certainly in order to your brother, Jack Brisco, for winning the 7th title.
Well, Gordon, Jack's got an awesome plan, and I feel like he's right on track, winning the 7th Heavyweight Championship. And, you know, also on the program, we have something coming up that Jack is after, and that's Ric Flair and the World Heavyweight Championship. And we'll get a chance to take a look at Ric Flair and how maybe the goal has changed him a little.
Exactly. We will be talking later on to Jerry about that specific thing when we do go to Atlanta and watch Ric Flair in action. Also, of course, Barbara Clary is with us, and Barbara, a lot of exciting things going to happen today.
Certainly are. We'll be seeing El Gran Apollo, who's a special favorite of mine. He is from Cuba, and he's a great, one of the great new athletes that have come around now. Also on our Take 5, we'll be talking with another great athlete, Ron Ritchie, after phone conversation.
Right. A lot of controversy surrounding Ron Ritchie, not on his part, but on the fact that protests have been filed about this young man, and Barbara had quite a conversation with him, and we'll be bringing part of that to you a little bit later on in the program. We do have a matchup coming here, and I might just point out that we're talking about Ric Flair, the World Heavyweight Champion. Also, later on, I'll be talking to Mr. J.J. Dillon. He's got a couple of things on his mind. He approached me just before airtime and said he had some things he would like to discuss, so we're going to move some time aside for Mr. Dillon later on in the program. Eddy Mansfield and Buzz Sawyer are facing El Gran Apollo and David Sierra, and what a combination and what a confrontation we're going to have here. Apollo has certainly proven himself time and time again. Dave Sierra, an outstanding young athlete, had some great matches against a man that I think thought he was going to take him with ease, Dory Funk Jr., and found out he couldn't, Jared.
Well, that's right, Gordon. In this match, we have four of the finest young athletes in the entire country today, and Buzz Sawyer, a continental lover, Eddy Mansfield, the action going on in the ring, Gordon, is just the greatest of time.
Sawyer very quickly makes the tag with Eddy Mansfield. Sawyer found out El Gran Apollo was too much to handle. El Gran Apollo, another beautiful arm drag takedown, makes the tag. And it is David Sierra moving out now against Buzz Sawyer. Reggie Park, the Iron Man, is the referee. Sawyer using a forearm very effectively now. Comes down with the elbow. Sierra was out of the way. Sierra had that arm briefly and lost contact, but Sawyer was committed, went to the canvas, back on his feet.
Well, boy, you know, you're moving at a tremendous pace out there. Sierra grabbed the arm there. As you see, he winged him right over. And he's got full control of it at this point here, Gordon.
Carrying the arm bar on him now, Sawyer pulls it back to the rope, fires him off, and Sierra catching him a good shoulder smash off the rope. Sierra up on the floor with his man, and Sawyer with a good leapfrog. Rolling reverse now by Sierra, may have it too. No, sir.
And this match, you'll never know when one's coming, Gordon, because all four of these men are extremely quick, extremely powerful. We've seen Buzz Sawyer with that power slam of his. We've seen Apollo, Sierra with those drop kicks they have. A continental lover, you never know how unpredictable this man is going to come with you. He is just totally unpredictable, and he'll come at you in all directions.
Sawyer made the tag, and Sawyer had a look of doubt crossing his mind. Sierra now with a series of forearms. To the side of the jaw of Eddy Mansfield, and that one rocked him again. And Sierra and Apollo now dishing out a lot of punishment to pass Eddy Mansfield.
Also, you might point out with Apollo and with Sierra, there's no language barrier, no communication problem. They're able to communicate in Spanish, so the tag team should be well oiled at this time.
Excellent point. And it is Buzz Sawyer closing in on El Gran Apollo once again. Apollo smashed into that far turnbuckle. The tag is made once again. No, sir, they do not. Yes, sir, now Mansfield moving in. Mansfield chopped across the head, used the elbow to the top of the head. Once again, the tag is made.
Good, quick tagging by Mansfield. By Sawyer here, they're really getting themselves oiled out for this long run, Gordon. And I believe it's Sawyer and Mansfield, they're going to be a problem if they stay together.
No question about that. And, of course, Jack and Jerry Brisco, the North American Tag Team Champions, here's a team that they're going to have to look at very, very carefully, very critically. In fact, both teams held ground to follow these beautiful forearm. Sawyer was locked up. He made the tag very quickly with Eddie Mansfield. Mansfield starts to move in. Apollo catches him with a boot. Mansfield trying to do what punishment and harm he can. Apollo fires back, and Apollo ducks away, comes off the rope. Beautiful cross body block. Mansfield powers out as Sawyer starts to come in. David Spear breaks it up. Apollo hurdled over that top rope. Whether that was intentional or not is hard to say. Very difficult to know whether that was intentional or not in the heat of that battle, Jerry.
Well, all I can say is Eddie Mansfield's very lucky that El Gran Apollo did not connect with that forearm, because he was blazing over there, and he ducked, and Apollo did go over the top, and they went by a disqualification.
Right. Automatic disqualification. El Gran Apollo and David Sierra, the victors in this match. I've asked Charlie Cook, the Florida heavyweight champion, to join Jerry and myself here at the desk at this particular time so we can all view this match together. Charlie, of course, has to be rated as a prime contender to go against Flair for that world title by virtue of the fact that you're the Florida champion.
Thank you, Gordon. I like to think of myself as the number one contender, because the man has the belt that everybody wants, and it'd be a feather in my cap if we would go in the ring and try to take that belt. And I think if I ever get a match with Flair, that I can.
I'll tell you what we're going to do. Rather than take any more time talking whatsoever, let's take a look at the brand new NWA World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Ric Flair, in action. This match took place in Atlanta, Georgia, and he was going up against Bobby Garrett. Now, I might just point out that just a week before Ric Flair garnered the World Heavyweight Championship, Jerry, he came to Florida, and he found the going down here mighty rough indeed.
Well, he sure did, Gordon. He ran up against the likes of Mike Gran and Jack Brisco, who both defeated this man, Ric Flair. And, you know, at times like this, your mind starts to thinking, well, if Flair was world champion, Jack and Mike right now might be.
Right, or Charlie Cook, or, of course, the man that he defeated, Dusty Rhodes, certainly has to be considered one of the prime contenders here. But the thing about Flair is his tremendous adaptability. And I think this is the thing that, that can so easily defeat any man who wins that World Heavyweight Championship, is lack of adaptability, because immediately he has to fulfill all of the contracts that have been signed by promoters all over the world, which means that his lifestyle changes dramatically in the space of a 3 months.
It does, Jordan. You're traveling all over, you're meeting the finest. If you're not versatile enough to change your approach, because each man that you face is an entirely different personality. You've got to know exactly, you've got to have a book on these guys. You've got to know what their style is, what they like the best, and what they cannot do and what they can do the best. So you see Flair here, he's trying to figure out this Bobby Garrett. He knows that Garrett cannot do anything as long as he's flat on the mat. And you see a style here for Ric Flair, a body ride there that you don't see too often. But you got to be versatile enough to change your style, confuse your opponent, and you can't ever go in with the same style.
That is for sure. Flair, of course, twice state amateur champion. He was in the collegiate ranks, was sought after by a host of schools, primarily throughout the entire Big Ten. Finally chose the University of Minnesota and was there both as a football player, track, and in wrestling. He's just an outstanding athlete, and he appears to, in my opinion, Jerry, and Charlie, I'll check with you for verification of this, too. He appears to have adapted himself quite well to the rather awesome responsibilities and tremendous challenges that the World Heavyweight Champion faces.
That's right, Gordon. When you hold the World Heavyweight Championship belt, you know that everybody's coming after you, and you got to go in the ring and put everything you got into it. And I would think this is what Flair has done. You know that everybody's coming up, and so he's going to try his best to do anything he can to keep that belt.
Well, a snap mirror just ran into a double side face lock now by Ric Flair, the World Heavyweight Champion in the purple trunk. And I might say, too, Jerry, when Jack won the World Heavyweight Championship, and he defeated Harley Race for that title, did you notice any changes coming over Jack after winning the title?
You know, Gordon,
to do, take certain steps to retain that championship, and you've got to do it.
Well, there's no question about it. That killer instinct, of course, is what every champion has to have. Now, watch carefully. Watch Flair. Sets this man. Brings him up. Verticals to play. Now, brings him backwards, and you saw there. There you can see the arm of Bobby Garrett. It's broken, no question about that. He brought him up into that vertical suplex, but Flair, not sure in his own mind whether this man is definitely out or not, is out of competition. Goes ahead, goes into that that variation of the figure four, comes from the opposite side, and puts the figure four on Garrett very quickly, concedes, and Flair, of course, realizing at that point, too, that the man's arm was also broken. So certainly it appears to me, Charlie, that Mr. Flair has developed that instinct of you must win the match, period.
That's right, Gordon. Anytime you got matches like that, you have to develop this instinct. You can develop them up again.
You learned that all these lists of challenges are going on, and you have made the mistake of not ever mentioning me. Ric Flair is not even the world's heavyweight champion. I am. I defeated Dusty Rhodes twice while he was a champion. I may not be recognized with the NWA, but I am the world's heavyweight champion. You and your claim, as far as this Florida heavyweight title is concerned, your claim to be the number one contender doesn't mean a thing to me. The only reason you've got that belt is because you've never wrestled me for it. Now let's clear the air once and for all, Cook. You and I, let's go in the ring right now and clear the air as to who is the number one challenger for the belt. If you've got the guts to do it, let's get it on right here and right now.
Well, now, just a second. I've asked Charlie to come on here. He has a match later on. And,
come on, boy. You afraid?
Come on, Gordon. I've taken all the verbal abuse I can take from this man. I'm going to sell this man some ball.
Come on.
Charlie Cook leading the desk, and apparently it's a... Charlie was scheduled for a match later as he charges the ring. It's the last connector, and Charlie Cook fires back, and we've got a free-for-all. Pier 6 are going here. Charlie Cook, that's working with everything he's got now. Charlie Cook, that's it to get past it. Drops him to the canvas, and Charlie Cook is after that man. Charlie Cook after him now. Jerry, well, let's have those cameras in close. It looks to me like we're going to get a picture of the assassin here. Wait a second, that's Ox Baker. Ox Baker just came out, and Baker after Charlie Cook, and now the assassin and Baker both have Charlie Cook outside that ring, and now both of them punishing Charlie Cook. We've got a two-on-one situation here, and somebody's going to have to put a stop to this situation. Wait a minute, there's Bugsy McGraw. Bugsy McGraw and Charlie, coming to Charlie Cook's aid. And now it's Bugsy McGraw and Charlie Cook taking it for Ox Baker. And we've got to get some order restored here. We've got to get order restored. We'll be back. Let's cut away to a commercial at this time, please. Let's cut away.
J.J. Dillon came to me shortly before airtime and with a rather unusual request about some films and one thing or another, and I'll let Mr. Dillon explain what was on his mind.
Well, Gordon, the problem seems to have arisen that last week I arrived for my initial appearance on Championship Wrestling. There are accusations floating in the air that I handpicked my opponent and the thing backfired on me, and that my initial appearance here was something less than spectacular. And I felt that I needed this time to make the point that I have never in my entire wrestling career ever been accused of handpicking any opponents for any matches. And I have a library that would be the envy of any wrestling promoter or any wrestling fan in the world of great matches of mine. And I have one match in particular that took place in Amarillo, Texas some time ago with Manny Fernandez, three times amateur champion in California, former Florida State heavyweight champion, and I think that would dispel any doubt as to the caliber of the competition that I face.
I'll tell you what, in the future, Mr. Dillon, I'd appreciate it if you'd give me a little bit more warning when you do have a videotape or film to be shown. Right now, then, let's switch to this match that he's referring to that took place in Amarillo, Texas, between Manny Fernandez and J.J. Dillon.
You're looking at in the blue corner from Atlantic City, New Jersey, coming in at 238 pounds, international heavyweight champion, James J. Dillon. Dillon. And his opponent across the way in the red corner, making his first appearance here on Championship Wrestling from San Jose, California, weighing in at 240 pounds, Manny Fernandez. Fernandez. Referee Terry Garvin waiting for the bell. There it is. And the bell sounds. Oh, here comes Dillon in behind very quickly. James J. Dillon in behind as Fernandez in the corner. Didn't even have time to get that jacket off as Dillon got to him.
The bell had rung, though.
And Dillon here wanting a quick victory. He doesn't want to stay in the ring here on Championship Wrestling too long. And he's afraid maybe Dick Murdoch might be hiding back in the wing and come get him.
That's a possibility. You know, right at this particular time, Jim Dillon is the international champion. But not only is he the international champion, we might review some of the other titles he's held.
Well,
in 1973.
Big fist.
Right.
He's trying to finish off this young man who makes his first appearance here on Championship Wrestling, Manny Fernandez. Oh, James J. Dillon with a knee. It's been all James J. Dillon. With that great list of credentials he's got there that he's fixing to tell us about if we can get a short break here in just a minute. As Dillon puts the boots to him now.
Jim Dillon, 1963 North American champion. In 1975, he was Florida Tag Team champion with Roger Kirby. In 1976, he was managing none other than the Stomper and also the Butcher, as we will.
Oh, yeah, the Outdoor the Butcher. Look here, Dillon. Fernandez, 240 pounds, slammed down as Dillon picked him up, threw him down, goes right after him. Manny Fernandez has not thrown one blow of any kind in this match. With a minute and a half gone, it's been all James J. Dillon.
Certainly has. Jim Dillon draping the ropes of Manny Fernandez over that rope. The referee calling for the break. Pulls him off. He hits that canvas very hard.
You know, Manny Fernandez sticks with three times California State Wrestling Champion in his weight division, so he's got the credentials.
You bet he has. There he's kind of rallying a little bit, Steve. This boy had a great disadvantage because Dillon charged him from behind immediately when the bell rang.
Down went Fernandez and Dillon got that boot in there. 2 minutes gone. Dillon in complete control, lays a fist on the jaw, pulls him back into the side, lays another fist in there. The referee, Terry Garvin, warned him about it. Then he puts Manny Fernandez down. What a way to have to start your wrestling career on television by stepping into the ring against James J. Dillon.
Right, let's see what Dillon. Dillon drops him across that rope. A hard blow to the throat. Dillon's still not trying to close in on this man. I believe he's got him without a doubt. I don't know what he's waiting on.
Trying to punish him. Let everybody know. Oh, did he get high in the air and got that knee up in there? This may be the end. Flying through the air. James J. Dillon, elbow smash.
Oh, he's still not going.
Here he comes off the ropes again. Well, let's see. Will he take the pin? 2, 3. It's all over. And it was all James J. Dillon, Nick.
Well, there's certainly no problem in recognizing, even though hairstyles and clothing styles may change over the years, your wrestling style certainly hasn't changed at all, Mr. Dillon.
No, and there's a prime example of how a momentary lapse in concentration on the part of a great athlete like Manny Fernandez at the beginning of the match, I just overwhelmed him, and it was all me from that point. But again, in case there's even one doubt in the back of one single mind, I would like to update things maybe a little closer to home. Going back several years ago when I last campaigned in Florida at a point when I was just beginning to mature in my own career, and I went against a man that was probably a living legend. He is a living legend right here in this area, and I'm certainly talking about Eddy Graham and a match we had, and right out of my own personal library, I would also like the fans to take a look at this.
All right, I'd appreciate your comments here, sir, and bearing in mind that it's interesting you've taken a man now who has since retired from professional wrestling and have chosen to bring him on the video screen in this manner.
Well, I'm sure that Eddy Graham, the legend that he is over the years, has a tremendous following in this area, a lot of fans, and I'm sure all the fans out there that endear themselves to Eddy Graham would enjoy watching this match also.
Down, and there's that famous right hand of Eddy Graham that rocked you and rocked you again. I must admit, however, that you have a tremendous sustaining powers.
Again, a picture's worth a thousand words. I can just sit here. I'm just impressed by what I see. Again, another situation where I totally dominated a great athlete in Eddy Graham.
Yeah, well, it also appears to me, sir, that it is your library, it is your film, your videotape, and certainly it appears to be your editing.
Well, that's beside the point. I would like to also clear a few things. I know that the eyes of the wrestling world for years have been on the scene here in wrestling in Florida because of the caliber of the wrestling competition. Every man at one time or another has had a dream of totally dominating the picture in this area, and I am no different. Now, it's also common knowledge that I have managed the affairs of several other wrestlers, and aside from competing actively myself, Playboy Gary Hart had a dream approximately 5 years ago of coming here and totally dominating the scene, but you see, he fell short. More currently, Sir Oliver Humperdinck, the House of Humperdinck, came to Florida. Again, he wanted to totally dominate the picture here, but he fell that much short. But you see, when you start to draw a comparison, Gordon Solie, the big difference between myself and a Playboy Gary Hart or a Sir Oliver Humperdinck is the tremendous wrestling knowledge that I personally possess. And I'm going on notice now to everyone in this area that I have a plan. I intend to totally dominate the wrestling scene here in Florida. Avalanche Tyler is not here by accident. It might as well be known he was here by design. And next week, right here, you will see the spoiler. I've been to Singapore. I put him under contract. The wheels are already in motion. Big things are going to happen, and I'm going to be right out the front of the, for lack of a better term, let's call it the Dillon Dream Team. I think that would be very appropriate. And the Dillon Dream Team, I'm talking about Avalanche Tyler, I'm talking about the spoiler, and I'm going to be mentioning more names in the week to come, and I'm going to be right out in front leading the pack. I will totally dominate the scene here in Florida and in very short order.
Indeed, a man with great ebullience, certainly a lot of excitement and great dreams and aspirations and of questionable probity. We'll be back in just a moment.
Kansas, weighing 262 pounds, Hangman Bobby Jaggers.
Jaggers and Sybert going up against it. It is Charlie Cook moving very swiftly. Jaggers a good high hip toss into a flying drop kick. Cook up with another flying drop kick. Sybert comes charging out into the ring as Sybert moves out into the ring. Charlie Cook catches him just as well, and Charlie Cook makes the tag. With Bugsy McGraw, Mr. USA. Who's out against Sybert. This is a wild right hand. This is another one. Bugsy McGraw, series of stinging left hands to the side of the jaw and into the ear of Sybert. Bugsy McGraw, uncorked though. Wild looping right hand. Drops Sybert to the canvas. Sybert. Armlift over to the far turnbuckle. Bugsy McGraw moves on his man once again. McGraw in total control here. Crashes down across the chest of Steve Sybert. Puts the far leg. They count it three and it's all over. The victors in this match in no uncertain terms. The combination of Charlie Cook and Bugsy McGraw.
This morning to talk with Ron Ritchie on the telephone, ask him what his plans were and what he thought about all the controversy about the top body block that he does have. So why don't we listen to that conversation?
Juggernaut heads at you from the top rope, there's no stopping it.
That's right, Gordon. And not only is he a good athlete, but I think that he's just really a good person to really think about the fans that much, come down, cancel his trip to Japan, and come back and see the fans.
I think, too, Barbara, that the man has great versatility for his age.
He certainly does. The top body block is not the only hold that he uses. We have a film of he and Reggie Parks wrestling, and he uses a different way to get the 10 count.
He does indeed, as we're watching right here as he upends Reggie Park. Beautiful backslide. Has those shoulders down in the count, and it is all over. And Ron Ritchie again shows, as we were just discussing, Barbara, great versatility.
Certainly does. He doesn't need the top body block. Of course, it is a very good hold for him to use. I've had a lot of mail. I know the fans in Florida and all over the country are really going to be excited about seeing him back.
Certainly no question about that. And according to the words of Ron Ritchie, then we'll be seeing him in action here next week.
We certainly will, and that's our Take 5 for this week.
You know, Gordon, it seems very funny once the word got out that I was responsible for bringing Avalanche Tyler to Florida. Once they saw him in action, one match in particular, which he defeated two men in a handicap match, all of a sudden Championship Wrestling was having a real problem trying to find suitable opponents. And frankly, I feel that the man signed to meet him today in this televised match is really not worthy in meeting him in one-on-one competition. So I don't know what I have to do. If I have to go into my bank account and get some money out and wave it under a few people's noses to instill a little courage in some of these so-called great athletes, that's what I'm willing to do. Now, I'd go so far as to say, Gordon told him, that I'll put up $1,000, but I don't want him to wrestle one man. I want him to wrestle two men, and I will go so far as to say that he will defeat two men with the Avalanche, do it within 10 minutes, and I'm putting up $1,000 that says he can do it.
Well, Mr. Dillon, I'm terribly sorry. We don't have time to take care of those sort of things right now. A match has been signed. Dorf Roach is in the ring. They're ready to meet Avalanche Tyler. So let's go to our ring announcer for the introductions of this match, please.
This match from Cincinnati, Ohio, weighing 210 pounds, Dorf Roach. His opponent from Nashville, Tennessee, weighing in at 325
pounds.
Yeah.
Mr. Dillon, I was watching the monitor in the dressing room. Did I hear things right? You're offering $1,000 for this guy to go against any two man he has to beat in 10 minutes?
That's correct. What are you doing here?
$1,000 is a lot of money. You know, I'm scheduled with a standby, man. But, you know, maybe I won't even get on the program, and I'd be more than willing to give it a chance.
Well, David, do you understand what you're getting into? Now, I'm saying I'll put up $1,000, but you and another man are going to have to wrestle the Avalanche, and I'm saying that he is going to beat both of you with the Avalanche within 10 minutes. Do you realize what you're getting into?
Yeah, I understand him. He's a rough guy, but I'm sure willing to give it a chance.
Hey,
be my guest. Well, listen, Gordon Solie, I don't have $1,000 cash on me. I don't have my checkbook, but I'm sure it shouldn't be a question of my being good for the money.
No.
My word is my bond.
Yeah, there's no question about that. I'll go along with it.
All right, it's agreeable. Avalanche will wrestle both in a handicap situation. He must Avalanche both of them. I say he can do it within 10 minutes. $1,000 is on the line.
Okay, that's it. Back to our ring announcer.
This is a handicap match. The stipulation being Mr. Tyler must defeat both men within a 10-minute time limit. Mr. Roach's partner from Louisville, Kentucky, weighing 222 pounds, Eric Emery. The $1,000 is on the line.
Hey, Eric Emery and Dorf Roach facing Avalanche Tyler now. Actually, then we're saying two falls in 10 minutes. Avalanche Tyler, a better than 300 pound, big, powerful man.
Young Eric Emery, Gordon Sosa, has got nothing to lose. And boy, after I've seen him around the country a few times, and this Eric Emery's a young athlete, and Avalanche Tyler's going to have his hands full beating one of them, let alone two of them. Well, that's a matter of personal opinion, Mr. Brisco. I've got $1,000 on the line, and I don't just indiscriminately throw my money around. I've got a lot of confidence in this man.
Embry slipping away again, twice now through the legs of Avalanche Tyler. Embry, very being the world
junior heavyweight champion. Embry's doing exactly the right thing, in my opinion, by going to one side, flipping around the man, not trying to meet him head on.
Well, you're exactly right, Gordon. He's got to be defeated, and I'd look for Eric Embry to try to go in and try to score a pinfall on him and Tyler and upset the whole work.
And Embry flips through again. Embry up on the field of flying dropkick has Avalanche Tyler. Now to the Kansas. And Tyler. Well, Embry. Had it in mind. Let's get as big a man as this is to offer seat. Jerry, you've said so many times, everybody's pretty much the same size on the mat.
Well, he's using the right strategy right there, Gordon. You got a big man like that, the safest place for a big man is flat on his back or on his stomach. And Emery got him down, went for a beautiful single leg takedown. He got him. He caught Avalanche Tyler coming and was able to get it. But you see the power in Avalanche Tyler and right back to the single leg again.
Mr., I don't know who this Eric Embry is. I've never seen him before. I don't know if somebody tried to slip a sleeper in on me or what, but I must give credit where credit's due. This youngster certainly has a lot of courage, even if he showed a little lack of good sense by coming out here in this situation. He's shining at the moment, but I'm confident it's not going to last very long.
Now we're a couple of minutes in already, and it is Embry now. Holding a definite advantage posture over Avalanche Tyler. And Embry trying to take away the mobility of Tyler.
He takes away one of those big tree trunk legs of Avalanche Tyler, Gordon. He's going to have no trouble with this man. We've seen some of the moves. He was an amateur wrestling champion. Eric Emery was. And you can see by the way he's working on that leg that he does know what he's doing in the ring. And whether or not he's a ringer or not, Jim Dillon might have put his money in the wrong place.
Listen, in fairness, let's be fair about this situation. Avalanche Tyler came out here mentally and physically prepared to meet one man. This was a rather spontaneous situation in which I directed this challenge. The boy came out here, and in fairness to Tyler, he did not come out here trained and prepared to meet two men on this occasion. Let's be fair about it.
Well, Mr. Dillon sounding somewhat concerned now. We're certainly willing to be fair about it, Mr. Dillon. You came out here, made the statement, talked about your wealth, your financial wherewithal, and the fact that he couldn't find any competition. Right now, he's finding that competition with Eric Embry. How long Mr. Embry can withstand the power and all of Avalanche Tyler, of course, remains to be seen, but then there's always no approach to be considered.
That's right, Jordan. I notice Mr. Governor constantly checking his watch there. Could it be that he sees those greenbacks fading away from him?
To say yet, but obviously we must have some consternation here on the part of J.J. Dillon. He is and he left the foot Eric Embry down to the canvas. Avalanche Tyler shot. Oh! Embry dropped to one side. Tyler out through the middle rope, and now yeah, time is a factor here.
There, Gordon, a good 20, 30 seconds is being wasted right now on Mr. Dillard's part with Avalanche Tyler, so it's getting near.
Well, I'll tell you what. Wait a second. He just grabbed Dorf Roach from, He caught Dorf Roach from behind and a full power slam through the canvas. He used the Avalanche on Dorf Roach. So, Dorf Roach down and out of it. He is of, looking at him here, he's out of camera range at this particular moment. And looking at him for myself, he is out of it. He is of no further use to Eric Embry now. Dorf Roach being attended to. And Avalanche Tyler. There's Reggie Parks out there, Dave Sierra, and Al Brown follow on helping. He had him. No, that's right. That's right. He didn't have the Avalanche.
Referee is right there, Gordon. He's got a win by an Avalanche. He was down for the 2-3 count. Eric Emery was. But the referee, then it was not an Avalanche, did not continue the count, and he was in the right.
He certainly was. And Emery has him to an inside cradle. He broke out of it. Avalanche Tyler, but Emery. knocked away from him again. And Embry now scrambling for his life as time is rapidly running here. Time is running. And just a there's two more minutes remaining. And it is Mr. Dillon, who is keeping very, very close track of the time now. Dillon was calling seconds ago for only 2 minutes remaining, and Embry keeps scrambling away.
The young man, Gordon, knows what he's doing in there. He's got Avalanche completely baffled right now. He knows the time. He's ducking out, and he does not have to defeat Avalanche Tyler at this moment. Avalanche Tyler's got to get him with that Avalanche, and it's less than a minute probably at this time here.
Who knows what the time like this here is. You're right, though. All he's got to do is scramble now. Stay on that bicycle. And Tyler did not. He had a pinfall, but he did not have the Avalanche, and the referee did not make the count of three. So this match is still under, and Embry still scrambling. And time continues to run, and Embry again, utilizing the outside ring rope. And Jerry, I've never been happy to see a man utilizing the ring rope, but I am today. Young Eric Embry doing everything he can to make that time disappear in that 10 minutes, and he'll be closer to that $1,000.
Well, it's definitely on his side now, Gordon. Time is on his side. It's now become a definite enemy to J.J. Dillon, Avalanche Tyler, and all this young man's got to do is just beat the count in and keep eluding Avalanche Tyler's Avalanche.
And it is, I heard Dillon play something about 45 seconds, and that would be about right, I would imagine, somewhere to 40 to 50 seconds remaining.
Hang on.
And Avalanche Tyler closing in, and this could be off the road for Eric Embry. But Embry, he's coming back. I don't know how much time it's... 15 seconds.
In a situation like this, did you feel that when your partner got hurt, when he was avalanched out here on the floor, that it would take anything away from your team?
Definitely, there's no guy to pass. Hey, the man in the ring, one of the toughest professionals in the business today. Because, like you said, I just watched the time, and I stayed away from him.
J.J. Dillon out there. Wait a second. Avalanche Tyler has grabbed the referee. They're blaming the referee. And Jerry Brisco in there, Eric Embry in there. And Avalanche Tyler has just avalanched the referee. And boy, is he catching it from J.J. Dillon now. Well, we'll have to be back. We'll be back in just a moment.